I'm Jim Blackburn. I am co-director of the Severe Storm Center at Rice University, where we've been studying hurricanes on the Texas coast, and particularly the vulnerability of the Galveston Bay system and Houston Ship Channel Industrial Complex. We are incredibly concerned about the vulnerability that exists. We are looking at storms that are unprecedented. We have 800,000 people that are at risk of deadly hurricane surge. We have 2.2 million barrels per day of refining capacity that likely would be shut down for 6 months to a year. We have 200 to 300 chemical plants that would be inundated and shut down for that same time period. It would be the worst environmental disaster in United States history. And we also are talking about really an economic damage that Houston would never recover from. We have got to defend the Houston Ship Channel and our population base on the west side of Galveston Bay. Surge is basically the water that comes in with the storm. The storm circulates in a counterclockwise way, and so it's pushing water with it as it comes ashore, and it's a bulge. And so there will be more and more water coming into the bay. And this water has waves on top of it, so it's violent water. This is not the gentle, kind of slow-rising water you get with a rainfall flooding. This is powerful, pounding. It's waves that are coming, and they break things up. And then the things that are broken get carried with the waves further inland. And so you have essentially the waves being battering rams that are taking debris, timbers, pieces of buildings, and are ramming it into storage tanks for chemicals. In Katrina, Murphy Oil had a tank that held about 250,000 gallons of crude oil that popped up off of its foundation and was lifted and moved about 50 or 100 yards, but it released the content. And what you have is, in that case, crude oil went into the adjacent neighborhoods.
So the Houston Ship Channel, of course, is the largest petrochemical energy center in the United States. The entire system of tanks, in particular, is only protected to about an elevation of 14 or 15 feet above mean sea level. Hurricane Ike, which was a fairly small event, 109-mile-an-hour event, hit Bolivar with 18 feet of storm surge. And if that storm had just shifted about 20 miles to the west, Houston would have seen impacts in the ship channel above 15 feet for sure. And in fact, if the winds had been larger, if the storm had been a little bit larger, if it had been a small Category 4 storm of about 130-mile-an-hour winds. So if you put those kind of storms on the ship channel, you easily get yourself to 26 feet and maybe even as high as 30 feet. And that will begin to float tanks, that will begin to create tank failures, that will move chemicals and product and leakage, and we will have one of the worst environmental disasters in the history of the United States. The Speed Center proposed the concept of the mid-bay. And it's a mid-bay solution with a navigation gate across the ship channel and then connecting into the Texas City Dike. It runs sort of north and south along and on the east side of the Houston Ship Channel. It then crosses the ship channel and comes across and connects into Texas City. It could really provide a great level of protection even without a complete coastal spine. The other big advantage of the mid-bay that we really liked is it could be built in maybe 4 to 5 years once the permits are in place. And also for a fairly reasonable cost of about $4 or $5 billion.
So, you know, when they first made the Houston Ship Channel, over the time of the dredging of the channel, they had been dumping those dredge spoils on the edges of the channel. So there are areas of the bay that have already been disturbed. And so if we couple the idea of using dredge material, but using it in a focused, intense way to create the storm barrier on the sites of these pre-existing dredge sites, but build it big enough, robust enough, so that it actually protects the key industries and populations of the west side. That's at the heart of the Mid-Bay Barrier Plan. The thing is that we can do so much more. And as we began to understand all the other opportunities that lie in this potential solution, the name actually changed and it became the Galveston Bay Park Project, because in addition to providing surge protection along the edge of the ship channel, we also suggested that we use the dredge material to create publicly accessible land. When we did some analysis, we found that in the whole perimeter of Galveston Bay, there's only about 500 acres of public access. And Galveston Bay Park would be 10,000 acres of public access to the bay. Think of it as a string of islands, sort of very big beads on a necklace. In between those beads are very small navigation gates that let recreational craft and daily water flow through. As the necklace comes down and crosses over, it's got one big gate. It's over 1,000 feet. It's got to take the super ships come through there. It's big, but it's also in the scale of technology that's being used around the world for similar reasons. So if you think about that string of islands connected by small gates, one large gate, and then imagine on those islands that there's a campground, boating, horseback riding, bicycling, running, a whole series of those kind of public events. Think about your favorite national park and everything you can do in that national park. These are the kind of things that we could begin to imagine happening in Galveston Bay Park. The Galveston Bay Park Project would save Houston, Harris County, and the Galveston Bay region from a staggering disaster. And in the end, you've got a park. It's fun. You're going to want to participate. You know, it's like, you know, protection I can play in. It's fabulous.